Don't be too concerned with the ego's objections. It's perfunctory. There's nothing really behind it. The objections will come up. Just don't engage with the objections, because they're always going to arise. Continue to look at the situation in its simplest format possible, in the simplest remedy possible. We don't need to get to relate to suffering and misery and death. We don't need to relate to that, because that's not what we are. What we are is flawless, perfect life without any sickness, death, or decrepitude. So we need to learn to relate to that. It's like we've been in a dream of sickness and death, and we've been trying to relate to this dream. Now it's time to relate to reality, first by a dream of freedom from sickness and death, and then reality itself. So it doesn't do us any good to display compassion, like, I feel your pain, I'm relating to your pain. That does us no good, doesn't get us anywhere, just enmeshes us even more in troubles. What the turnaround has to be is we need to start relating to freedom from misery, suffering, fear, death. We start relating to that. But where do we find that? Now, Ramana Maharshi said, by the self. It's within us. And he likened it, the trouble that we have is we're trying to relate to freedom from misery and suffering externally. So we want to make the world a beautiful place so we can relate to it. And this is something that I have done, so I'm speaking from experience. I mean, I work myself almost to death to try and make the surroundings very beautiful, so I feel like I'm relating to something beautiful. But what's left out of the equation is my terrible suffering. I got terrible back pains now, and my foot hurts, and I'm exhausted, and just suffering badly from too much work that I can't handle anymore to try to make things beautiful. So I'm suffering terribly. That's left out of the equation. When we try to make the world, external world, something that reminds us of no suffering, of ease, of freedom from want and scarcity, freedom from death, disintegration, decrepitude, sickness of all types. When we do that, we ourselves end up stressed out and suffering badly. So it doesn't work. Ramana Maharshi said, if you want to remove the suffering, don't try to remove all the stones and thorns on the path of the world. Put on a pair of shoes. Okay, very simple. Put on a pair of shoes. In other words, abide in the self. So there is supposedly something within us that can be present to our mind, so that our mind can relate to that which is free of suffering. That's the whole goal of the spiritual path, is to get to the point where you are willing to abide with this, that which is free of all suffering, all impermanence. And it is supposedly within. It is not some, so it's with you. It's a portable paradise. It's always with you. Wherever you go, whatever you're doing, it is there. It's inside you. It's in within your mind, as it were. It's like a gift of God, the grace of God. The Holy Spirit is in your mind and presents this reflection of reality into your mind so that you can relate to it. Learn, get used to relating to that instead of relating to all the sickness and impermanence. For instance, everything that I've done here, all the planting flowers everywhere, etc., they're all going to die within a matter of, you know, months, maybe 6 months. The winter will come, all the vegetables will wither on the vine and die. I have to pull all the dead stuff out. Constant massive amount of work to try and give this sense. What I'm trying to do is relate to something beautiful that seems not sick and not decrepit and beautiful. But that way requires enormous efforts and expenditures and trouble and water, constant water and fertilizing and care, and bugs come. I've got a mole, I've got a gopher attacking stuff now, you see. So it's very stressful and just a ton of work. It's so much work that I really never even enjoy it, actually. I never stop and smell the roses because I'm too busy, you know, taking care of the roses. So That is like walking on a path and trying to pick up all the thorns and stones as you go along, constantly stooped over, picking this up. What's going to happen? You're going to get a terrible backache, right? So what the great sages tell us is that there is something within us that we can relate to that reminds us of reality. So we need to learn to relate to reality once again. And then once we relate to reality, then we can drop even the relating and be reality. Realize that we've never left reality. But first, we need to relate to it. And it cannot be like another person, because the body, you see the body, and you can see the body is getting older, and the body moves around, and it's not always close to you, it's somewhere else, it moves around. So it has to be something within us that is cannot be distanced by external situations and events and time, that it's not affected by time and space, that it's no matter where we are, it is with us. It is with us. That's the goal. That's the goal. So we just need to make a simple prayer that say I request that the presence of I request this presence that I can relate to the presence of reality that I, so I can learn to relate to it, so I can begin relating to that. Simple request, simple request. So again, we're boiling it down to the simplest format. What we need is to have the opportunity to relate to that which is free of suffering, effortlessly free. It's free. It doesn't cost us anything. It doesn't cost us any work. Doesn't cost us any expenditure, is with us always, and we can. It's a true friend, in other words, a true, the true, truest of all true friends. And we need to learn to relate to that, get used to relating to that. So the prayer is that this presence that we can relate to, the presence that is free of all suffering, effortlessly free of all suffering, decrepitude, sickness, decay, death. Be present in our mind so that we can learn to relate to it. Very simple. We are not supposed to be relating to suffering. People are suffering and they say, well, you just can't relate to my suffering. You don't know how I feel, etc. Well, it doesn't matter. We should turn that around and say, well, you cannot relate to my freedom from suffering. And that's what you need to relate to. You need to be able to relate to freedom from suffering, not to suffering. Suffering itself is impermanent. All dreams are impermanent. Hypotheticals are impermanent. The idea of impermanence is impermanent. It won't last. That's not our true identity. It's not our true life at all. So there's no point in learning to relate to suffering. It's a dead end. It's a completely dead end. So learning to relate to this, to the presence, the suffering-free presence. Is the objective, and it's something that many are trying to do, and we have to keep at it because the times require that, require it of us. The world actually is becoming what I call imbecilic, and many of you realize this. It's easier to realize it if you have some perspective. For instance, I was born in the 50s, 1950s. So the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, and then you can look at now where we're at 2013, and then look back in the 50s and 60s and say, okay, what's happened in that same time frame? And what I see is that the world is going toward imbecility, actually. Not intelligence at all, imbecility. Truly. And the corollary to imbecility is, of course, people think that they're progressing. They're becoming way better. Defining imbecility is better. Imbecility means the unawareness of what your responsibilities are, what the true goal has to be, what you must accomplish, which is to relate to the presence, the suffering-free presence within your mind. That is what everyone must do, because the path of suffering is a dead end. It's a dead end. And the world is losing sight of that. Is losing sight. Not only that, but it is becoming all frilly and frothy, as it were, like a latte or something. It's all these bubbles, and people are obsessed with all the froth on your coffee, latte, whatever, frappuccino, mocha, blah blah blah, becoming. See, look at all the bubbles. Look at all the froth, the foam, the foam. The frilly, the foamy, and losing sight. They're studying the bubbles, little bubbles. Oh, look at that one. Look at that little bubble. Look at that little bubble. Someone comes in and says, hey, you know, you're holding a cup of coffee, and you're sitting in a coffee place, bistro, whatever you want. I don't know what you call it. Cafe, you know, on a boulevard, in a day, in a life. In the world, and your body is aging, and you're getting older, and everything is decaying on the planet, and what is your purpose, etc. No, they're saying, oh, look at this little bubble, and this little bubble is connected, is right next to this little bubble. It is, look at all these little bubbles, isn't this interesting? Little whipping up milk, you know, into froth. That's imbecility. Just the writing, like on the internet, the content on the internet, it's imbecility, absolutely imbecility. We used to be able to express ourselves with much, much, much greater clarity and depth. Way, way more. Be able to focus. There was a depth, more depth. Not that it was something great by any means, but in comparison to now, It seems way more depth. We weren't so caught up in the bubbles, in the foam, in the froth, in this incredible irrelevancy. So obsession with irrelevancy is imbecility. And so we live in an imbecilic culture, imbecilic world at this time. And that's not helping anybody, actually. It's just a delay. It's just a delaying tactic, is all. So, but we don't need to go along with that trend, even though it's all-encompassing right now. That's why the is a necessity to reach the goal at this time. Otherwise, the imbecility is going to pull everybody down the drain. It's just amazing. You get some. The culture is elevating those who are imbecilic into the highest status now. Oh, look at that little bit of foam. Oh, it's that little bit of foam. So wonder. Oh my God, I'm reacting to that little bit of foam. And yo, you're reacting too. Maybe you're reacting to the other little bit of little bubble there. Oh my gosh, we're reacting to the bubbles together. Oh wow, look at this bubble. And you know. Culture's constantly now elevating the imbecilic to greater and greater and greater and greater prominence. The people that are in prominence in the world now would have been on the lower echelons previously. People would have said, "Well, you know, this imbecility. I'm not interested in this nonsense." So it's like 180 degrees reversed right now, and. You have a massive dumbing down of the culture that has taken place, a massive dumbing down. So we can continue to grow crops of imbeciles, of sacrificial crops, really, is what it is. Spirit just keeps churning out this continuous sacrifice. Those aspects of spirit who are still deluded are just seriously into churning out more and more crops of sacrifice. More and more sacrifice. To distract the supposed imagined annihilator, boogeyman, away from spirit onto those bodies. onto this stage, thinking that this stage is where it's happening, where life is happening. And so therefore, if you want to annihilate life, this is where you have to put your attention, annihilator. That's the game the spirit's playing. But not all aspects of spirit are so dumbed down. And they're saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, this is all unnecessary. We need to learn to relate to freedom from suffering. And this world's not helping us do that at all. So we are told there's that within us which is free of suffering. I've had a few glimpses of it, a number of glimpses of it. It's been quite some time, actually, since I've had a glimpse of it. But I guess once you get some glimpses, then you know what the goal is, and you can work towards it. And maybe it kind of waits on that and says, okay, you know the goal, so I don't need to, you know, pushing yourself. But that definitely, it's definitely there. It's definitely there. It is like a complete problem-free state. And when you begin to relate to that, there's a perfunctory reaction from the ego that says, oh, you can't do that. You can't do that. That's you're going to be annihilated, you know. In other words, because you're not projecting a dummy that is suffering, etc., giving evidence of annihilation, interacting with it, that somehow annihilation is then going to turn towards spirit and get you like that. But this is all based on a fundamental delusion and arrogance of the spirit, that somehow spirit believes it can attack reality, whereas it cannot. So it cannot harm reality in any way. We cannot sin against God. We cannot sin against ourselves. It's impossible. The ultimate arrogance is to say we can sin against God. That's the ultimate arrogance. In other words, we're saying God is vulnerable to our attack. It's not true. There's no attack in reality. And since only reality is real, this boogeyman that's attacking must be unreal, which means it's based on our own imagination. It's something we've simply conjured up hypothetically, saying, what if this were possible? So this whole scenario is a what if this were possible. It's not an actual scenario at all. This world, everything that we're experiencing is a what if scenario. No actuality to it whatsoever. However, if we don't see this, our imagination is so incredibly rich and creative and presents such an incredible tapestry to us that we assume that it's actual. And therefore, we feel this great necessity to defend against annihilation. Because the effort to change reality is the effort to annihilate reality. And since we're making that effort, we believe that it must be successful. Otherwise, why would we make an effort that's impossible? So the fact that we're making the effort to try and change reality and make spirit make itself prime creator means we believe it is possible, which means we believe in annihilation. See, that's the other side of the coin that people we're not aware of. The other side of the coin of believing we can change reality is annihilation. Because reality is one indivisible whole, so we try to change it. That would result in total annihilation of spirit as well, because we're one with reality. So when we are entertaining this idea of wanting to be prime creator, that automatically gives rise to this belief in annihilation, and spirit believes that spirit can be annihilated. So then it defends against this, which is then producing all these temporary forms of dust that it defines as life forms, and all this activity it defines as life, to distract annihilation away from spirit onto this quote-unquote defined as life. And this life has all this evidence of being attacked. It's all being attacked. And so spirit can look at it and say, ah, you see, annihilation is attacking all this life out there, but it's not attacking, you know, spirit in here, as it were. So spirit feels safe as long as it sees all this attack taking place externally. Spirit feels a certain measure of safety. At least it's not completely freaking out in terror. So this is literally the dream, the nightmare that we're engaged with. But do we need to learn to relate to that? The answer is no. Does us no good whatsoever. It's all what if hypothetical scenario. So it's very important in order to see all this, to recognize the origin of it, which is a hypothetical scenario, which is spirit wanting to be prime creator, choosing the idea, saying, hey, I wonder if I can do this. Let me try to do this. And then believing it's possible, just for the heck of it. Let's believe it's possible. Not realizing that the belief that it's possible brings up the belief that annihilation of spirit is possible, which brings up enormous terror in spirit and the necessity then for spirit to try and to cut down this terror it feels by distracting annihilation, believing it can distract this annihilation away from spirit onto something that is not spirit, but what is supposedly defined as life. That it can distract it onto bodies, onto worlds, onto situations, and therefore this vast cauldron here that we call life, constant death everywhere, constantly. Everything is decaying. It's built up, then it decays and dies. Built up, decays and dies. Constant evidence that annihilation is feasting on this, and therefore spirit feels that it's temporarily has a little measure of safety. That's all that this gives spirit is a temporarily, there's a little reprieve, a sense of maybe safety might be possible, but it's always very jittery about it, because it knows this is all fake life and it's just an imaginary projection, and it's worried that maybe annihilation will figure that out at some point. So it wants to dampen down any teaching in the world. So he doesn't want anyone taught the truth. And no aspects of spirit say, wait a minute, I want to relate to that which is free suffering. I don't want to have the body attacked. I don't want any attack on anyone or myself. The other aspects of spirit say, no. That's will raise our anxiety level, you know. So there's that catch-22 in the situation. And generally speaking, in order to teach, in order to witness here, you cannot mainstream it. We cannot mainstream it, because that gets people too jittery. The spirit feels its safety is dependent on ignorance of what's its own ignorance of what's going on, and the ignorance of annihilation. It doesn't want annihilation to catch wind of, well, maybe these bodies in this world is not real life. It doesn't want annihilation to catch hold of that. But the fact is there is no annihilation. There isn't. We personify it. We make idols out of it in order to make it seem more realistic. But there is nothing other than our own imagination. There's no external annihilator. There's no external dynamic, no external force. We make it all seem external, so we seem safe from it. It's like a distance ourselves by externalizing, like there's all this external annihilation taking place. But it's actually just the play of our imagination, spirit's imagination. But spirit, the way spirit does it, it says, well, first I'll make myself safe from this, and then I'll consider about, you know, other stuff. But it doesn't work. First, spirit has to recognize that the origin of this is the desire to be prime creator. Then it has to decide, hey, this fear of annihilation is inexorably part of this idea. It can't separate it out and defend against it and get rid of it. It's impossible. The best spirit can do is this constant sacrifice with this idea. That's all it can do. The best that spirit can ever do with this idea of wanting to be prime creator is a constant sacrifice of attack and death and impermanence. That's the best it can do. So what spirit needs to do is decide, hey, let me take up the hypothetical of what if reality were permanent and I can't change it and I can't become prime creator? What if that was the case? And then the abidance with the suffering-free presence is possible. That arises as a corollary from that idea. No need for attack, no need for sacrifice, no need for externalization, no need for projection, no need for defensiveness, no fear, anything like that. So we need to exchange one hypothetical for another. What we're saying is, what if reality were impermanent? And then the other hypothetical is, what if reality were permanent? The hypothetical, what if reality were impermanent, has this inexorable aspect of the fear of annihilation and a constant sacrifice to try and defend against that. That's inevitable. That's two sides of one coin. It's part of it. It's one with this idea. You cannot separate it off. It's impossible. And the other does not have that corollary at all. It doesn't require any. The other hypothetical, what if reality were permanent, doesn't have that at all. Doesn't have any fear of annihilation, therefore no need to defend against it, no need for impermanence, attack, all of that stuff. So you can relate to freedom from impermanence and suffering. It's really that simple. So when we choose the hypothetical, what if reality were impermanent, the overwhelming facet of that idea is the fear of annihilation. And spirit absolutely has to defend against that. Otherwise it would be completely submerged in overwhelming dread. So nobody is saying keep the idea of that reality is impermanent, but give up your defenses of fear. Nobody's saying that at all. That would be crazy. What is being said is exchange your idea from what if reality were impermanent to what if reality were permanent and couldn't be changed. And then from there, the overwhelming necessity is to abide with, relate to the problem-free presence. Stress-free, suffering-free, problem-free, death-free, sickness-free presence within your mind. That is the facet of that idea. So no one is attacking the world or what the people are doing. No, it's as long as the idea is wanting to find creator, then all this stuff, sacrifice is necessary. Absolutely. I'm not saying stop it. No. I'm saying look at the root of it and then exchange hypotheticals. That is the teaching. So, of course, if we choose the idea that reality is impermanent, we'll have this dread of annihilation, and we'll have to defend against that dread, in which will be this continuous sacrifice. Of course, there's no two ways around that whatsoever. None. It's just a question of who's going to lose what, and when. But it's constant loss, and all we have is like a temporary thing. Well, I got some pretty flowers here for a little while, and. You know, but I'm going to lose those. And I have a little bit of this and a little bit of that, but I'm going to lose that. It's just a constant loss. That is necessary for that idea. There's no way you can dispense with it. Impossible. Because if you try to dispense with it, you feel this complete, overwhelming terror and dread and experience total chaos, which is, you cannot do it that way. It's impossible. The mind recoils from that total chaos and says, no. That's not, I cannot function that way. So, what we're saying is, choose a new idea. Choose once again. Exchange hypotheticals. That is the teaching. Not an attack on the world. The world, the craziness of the world, the imbecility, it's all necessary. So let it be, let it function the way it's functioning, because it's necessary to defend against total chaos within the context of the hypothetical that reality is impermanent. Absolutely. There's no way out of that. However, we can choose a new idea, a new hypothetical, exchange hypotheticals. We can make the exchange. That's the way out of it. That's the only way out of it. So it is futile to rail against the world too much, really. Obviously, we don't like it. But it serves a purpose, which is defending against this experience of total chaos, which is how annihilation is symbolized. Since annihilation is just imaginary, it can't actually take place. It symbolizes it in our mind. We symbolize it as total chaos, total mental chaos. And to defend against that, it is necessary to have all this sacrifice taking place, so spirit can imagine that there's a way to avoid this chaos. Limit loss, a way to limit loss and limit chaos, a limiting of it. It's a gradualism, as it were, continual gradualism, you might call it. This continual gradualism is necessary with this idea. It has to be there. So don't tilt at windmills and think that you can somehow make a perfect world and get rid of the problems and suffering. No, that's ridiculous. Or it's a waste of time to get upset about the world the way that it is. It has to be that way. It has to keep constantly changing, shuffling the deck, putting new suits of clothes on the meat suits, new meat suits constantly, with new attitudes, new this, all. But it's all the same, exact same parade. The parade route's the same. The parade route is exactly the same, except the costumes are different. And the floats are different, and the banners are different. But the exact same parade route. Just a death march is what it is. It has to be that way. There isn't any other way around. There's no way around it. But to be free of it, you have to choose a new idea. The idea of that reality is permanent. What if? We're not saying it is. We're saying, what if reality is permanent? What if? Then what? See? So that's continuity. We're used to, what if reality was impermanent? Then what? And we're stuck in this terrible defense against annihilation or mental chaos, which is, that's the experiencing of this idea. And then we can say, well, what? Let's choose the idea. What if reality was permanent? And then we can relate to the presence of permanence, as it were. We can relate to the presence, but we're not yet. We don't have to drop hypotheticals yet. We can say, well, what if? What if means relating to it rather than being it. Rather than just abiding, actually being it, there's a relating to it, an abiding in it, as Ramana said, abide in the self. He didn't say be the self, abide in it. That's a relating to it, you see. That's the step that enables continuity, maintain the continuity of hypotheticalness. And then once we learn to relate to it and become totally familiar with the presence, suffering-free presence, the presence of permanence and stability and oneness, then we can drop hypotheticals and be it again and realize we never left. We were just dreaming that we left. We're just dreaming of the separation, dreaming of this hypotheticals. It was just a dream. But we don't need to wake up from the dream directly. We need to dream a different dream. Instead of relating to sacrifice, we relate to non-sacrifice. Instead of relating to death, we relate to life. Instead of relating to impermanence, we relate to permanence. Instead of relating to fear, we relate to freedom from fear, peace. And instead of relating to instability, we relate to stability. So this is the emphasis, and bringing the mind back to that emphasis is necessary. So what we're saying is, let go of the world. Let the world be the way that it is. Don't try to improve upon it. Don't try to stop this or stop that or rail against this or rail against that, because it is absolutely necessary to defend against mental chaos, which is what arises when we believe that reality can be changed, that it's impermanent, is actual total mental chaos. And it is absolutely necessary to defend against that. I've experienced it, and it was only for an instant, and then I saw that the mind has to defend against that. It's impossible to abide in mental chaos, impossible. So the defense against that is this. We've built up this massive defensiveness against that, as the mind must do that. However, we're spirit, which is higher authority than mind, and we can choose a new idea. We can exchange hypotheticals. We have the authority to do that. Mind doesn't have the authority to do that. Mind is a servant. The servant has no authority to choose ideas. Mind presents the ideas that spirit chooses. So mind has to present all this sacrifice as a defense against mental chaos. It has to do that based on the idea that spirit chose, the impermanence of what if reality were impermanent? Meaning what if it could be changed and spirit could become prime creator? That would mean that it's impermanent, right? That the will of God is not stable or permanent at all. So mind has to present this scenario. Has to, and the scenario has to be the way it is. And we can't really be changed in any real way at all, an actual way. It has to be this perpetual sacrifice. But spirit can choose a different hypothetical and say, what if reality is permanent and can't be changed? Will of God can't be changed. Then mind presents that idea, which is the presence of bliss, the problem-free presence. Problem-free presence within the mind, and the mind relates to that hypothetical. So it's relating to that, abiding within that. So it's either one or the other. Either we're relating to bliss, or we are relating to suffering. But you cannot bring bliss to suffering, nor can you bring suffering to bliss. That's impossible. Because they're two different ideas. The effects of one idea cannot cross-contaminate the effects of another idea. That's impossible. The problem-free presence is problem-free. Now, how we relate to it can be affected, but the actual presence itself cannot be affected by the impermanence and problem, the problematical situation. So, suffering will always be suffering and bliss will always be bliss. It's just a question of which one do we want to relate to. And again, the ego will object, but let's not go down that road of reacting to the ego's objections. Of course, the ego can raise objections. What else can it do? It's defending against total mental chaos. So it anything that is not sacrifice, the ego objects to it, of course. But again, we're talking about a different idea, the effects of a different idea. We're not trying to change the effects of this idea of what if reality were impermanent? We're not trying to change alter the effects of that at all. We're just saying we can choose a different idea with different effects. That is the real path to salvation. So we're not going to go into hospitals and walk around and heal everybody from their afflictions. Because that would seem to be an attack on defensiveness, you see, and it would have great backlash. So you wonder why don't the gurus go around heal everybody? No. That would be very unwelcome. What would happen is some other illness would come back, something worse, doubly bad, or something would come. What the guru does is simply say, "Hey, look, this is an option. Here's your option. You can choose this instead. You can choose this instead of this, but not to try to remove the effects of the other idea, not to go around healing everybody and saying, just get rid of all the effects of impermanence or something. No, because as long as you maintain the idea, hypothetical, of what if reality were impermanent, could be changed, the defensiveness of these sicknesses is necessary. It's required. Because otherwise, you would start experiencing this terrible anxiety and leading to total mental chaos. So it's these illnesses, sicknesses, these bodies, the struggles and suffering we go through that actually defend against this mental chaos. They actually defend against it. So it is not right to remove the defenses by like healing somebody and making them feel well, making them free of suffering. It is not right to do that. Of course, everybody wants to get rid of their suffering, but they don't realize the deeper problem, the backlash that will come. So it's better. What is whatever suffering you're going through is to just accept it and say it's a necessary defense against mental chaos. However, I can choose a new idea where mental chaos doesn't arise at all, and I can relate. There's that within me I can relate to, the problem-free, chaos-free, death-free, suffering-free presence. That I can relate to that. And it's always with me. In other words, it's stable. It's not something outside that can be taken away from you. So again, allow the world its suffering. Allow the world its death. Allow the world all its troubles. And recognize it's necessary. This is something that just came up today in doing this video. I mean, it's got to be the Holy Spirit speaking to me, you know, as it were, because I didn't see this yesterday. Yesterday I didn't see this, but I'm seeing it now. So we wonder, where are the gurus? How come they're not out in the world changing the world? How come they're not go out healing everybody? No. You can't do that. That'd make things worse, as a matter of fact. Makes things worse. When you take away a necessary defense against mental chaos, then panic will ensue, and they'll say, wow, that illness wasn't strong enough defense against it, so I'm gonna have to double the illness. Make it even worse now to defend against that. So things get worse, not better. So you might say when we say the world's getting worse, it's that the wrong focus is in the world of trying to get rid of the suffering of the world, to try to make it a utopia, okay? But I guarantee you, the more you go down that road, the worse it gets. It gets doubly worse. It gets exponentially worse. The more we try and remove suffering from the world, the more we double down on suffering. Which is why I say we're headed for a terrible global sacrifice. Because the more we try and get rid of our suffering, which is a defense against mental chaos, we strip ourselves of that, the more closer we get to that mental chaos, and then the more we feel, oh my gosh, I've got to defend against this, and what I did before wasn't strong enough, so I need to double the strength. I need to make it twice as terrible so it can't be taken away from me. So mental chaos is such a terrible experience that you would easily suffer a lifetime of horrible suffering and torture and death rather than experience it. So when we try to make the world free the world from suffering by all these, you know, what we're trying to do, make it a utopia as far as medicine and all these various things we do, education, medicine, everything we're trying to do in the world to make ourselves happier and healthier and get rid of all suffering and troubles and torments. It literally is making things much, 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 much worse down the road a little bit, down the road a little bit. Initially, we think, hey, this isn't so bad. I'm starting to get free of suffering. This is great. And then the backlash, you start having backlash, you start having depression. The rates of depression have absolutely skyrocketed as we've gone toward this great society that we're trying to construct, this utopia. Mental illness has increased terribly. And because these defenses are necessary. So the thing is, don't try to make the world a better place. Let the world be a place of suffering, and then actually, by allowing that suffering to be, you're not making it worse. It has to be there. So there's two things. One, it has to be there. There has to be defense against annihilation, and it has to be a sacrificial story. But two, you can make it worse. You can make it even worse if you try to get rid of that. You make it worse, much worse. So the way to be compassionate to the world is to let it be the way that it is. Don't try to get rid of suffering in the world. Let it be, let the suffering be there. That is a reflection of the desire to be prime creator. Okay, and to defend against the fear of annihilation is necessary. And so those who are engaging with this world, they're simply trying to experience this idea of what if reality were impermanent, and they therefore they need this sacrificial defense against the fear of total mental annihilation, which plays out as total mental chaos. They need it. So let it be that way, and then be in the world and simply say, look, I'm not trying to change the world or take any of your defenses away. I'm simply telling you that you can choose a different idea, and then the necessity of defending against annihilation and mental chaos isn't there at all. Therefore, you do not need to project any sacrifice at all. See, that is what the way that it is. The more we try and free the world from suffering, the worse the suffering will get. This requires a great clarity, because it seems non-compassionate, doesn't it? It seems non-compassionate. We feel like, oh no, we need to relieve the suffering of the world. Not true. Just the opposite. We need to let the suffering be what it is. We need to give up resistance to that, and realize that it's necessary. It's the lesser of two evils, as it were. Absolutely. It's necessary. Because it defends against this state of mental chaos, which is way, way worse than any suffering we experience in the world, by immeasurably worse. Having, again, I experienced that, I can tell you, it's immeasurably worse than any of the suffering that we experience in the world. It's literally insufferable. The experience of mental chaos is literally insufferable. Everything else seems like almost like nirvana compared to it, you know, even though it's still suffering. But it's at least the suffering of the world is sufferable, okay, whereas mental chaos is insufferable. So we're on the horns of a dilemma where we're choosing the lesser of two evils. And how can that be? Why should that be denigrated? Should not. So, of course, people in this world, they're constantly gravitating towards trying to get at least a little comfort. They basically say, hey, I've got to suffer, I've got to go through this, but I just want a little bit of coziness and comfort, and that's all I can ever ask for. Yeah, that's pretty much it. So, by looking at this way, the scorn of the world is removed. The idea of like, why are these people suffering? That's crazy. It's removed. It's not crazy. it's actually all that can be done. Within the context of the idea of what if reality were impermanent, that's all that can be done. That's it. There's no grandiose elevation of the whole thing. Never will be. All these ideas of removing suffering from this idea, the notions of removing suffering from this idea, are pie in the sky nonsense. Sacrifice is absolutely necessary to defend against mental chaos. In the context of the idea of what if reality weren't permanent, it's absolutely necessary. No way around it. However, we can choose a new idea where what if reality is permanent. So that is the way around it. It's not a way around it. It's a way to exchange it. I believe that when you see there's no way around it, then it makes the exchange a lot easier, right? There's no way around it, so what can I do? Exchange hypotheticals, obviously. As long as we think there's some way around it, we're locked in delusion. I've often wondered, how come the gurus don't come and free us from our suffering? They don't come and, you know, cure your illness, your ailments. Now they know that would make things worse. So it's compassionate to let you suffer, let you have your suffering, and then work on the level of exchanging ideas. That's what's been done. It's not my suffering hasn't disappeared, but my capacity to look at options has clarified. And it's necessary this time to get this clarification because the backlash is coming. See, the world is ignorant. It doesn't understand this dynamic. It thinks that somehow by removing suffering that we're making progress. No. We are actually making it worse. And what happens is everyone seems to be kind of content in the world. However, by stripping away some of the defenses towards mental chaos, there comes a time when that fear of mental chaos will impinge upon consciousness, and people will not feel defended against it, and then they will go overboard in defending against it. They'll go overboard. That's why I say the world is not stable. The situation is not stable in this world. It's very possible for a sudden collapse of civilization. Very possible. Precisely because the defenses against this mental chaos have been lessened to some extent, which will bring about a sudden doubling down. Sudden doubling down, they say. People will look and suddenly they'll say, oh my gosh, I see this mental chaos. And then they'll flee from it into greater sacrifice. So civilizations are set up to collapse. Civilizations basically try to bring opulence and comfort and try to remove suffering to some extent, as we have, the modern world is trying to do. Everyone's being immunized, everyone's being fed, everyone's being taken care of medically, this and this and this and this, and we're all being promised a wonderful life. And we all have our, you know, big screens and 1,000 channels and on-demand video and on-demand events. We can tune into any events in the world. We feel like the world is our oyster. And we're the pearl that is just enjoying it. Enjoy. All the wonderful food now we have. Shopping, you can get anything. Click, and 2 days, 3 days later, it's at your doorstep. We think, wow, we're really close to removing suffering. But inevitably, there's an inner arising of a sense of vulnerability to something. We're not even sure what it is, but it's actually the state of mental chaos. And then we'll say, oh my gosh, we're not defended against this. And then suddenly the psyche, the consciousness of the planet can change like that. And people can all go all in together on saying, wow, we need to have better defenses against this. And everyone will agree. They say, yeah. And they say, okay, we need to just start sacrificing like crazy. Like crazy. And everybody will go along with it, I guarantee you. Because if the alternative is mental chaos, people will engage in any sort of sacrificial behavior whatsoever. And seeing it as way, way, a great deal. Like a super wise, smart, great deal. And then actually it is. Compared to mental chaos, it is. So if they can purchase a little distancing from mental chaos through planetary sacrifice, they absolutely will do that. Guaranteed. So that's why it's necessary to have this state of clarity and non-resistance to what is, to how things are, and not feel, the idea of trying to remove suffering, if you don't, you feel like a failure. I remember somebody, who was it? Somebody was asked, maybe it was a dream I had, I asked some super accomplished person, I said, what do you want to say about your life when you're ready to pass on? And they said, well, I just want to know that I've made the world a better place. That's all. Meaning I've alleviated some suffering. I've gotten rid of some suffering here. I've made it better. This world a better place. And I think that's what most people feel, is they feel they want to alleviate the suffering. I know I certainly do. I feel I want to, I see all the suffering in the world. I say, oh my gosh, I want to cure, find a cure for this. I see the old people. I say, oh my gosh, I don't want to be that way, and I know that they don't want to, and so let's find a cure. You know, we're all obsessed. Let's find a cure. Absolutely. And so when we're not able to, we get frustrated, and we get angry at the world. We say, people are not, they're stupid. They're not playing along. How come they don't get it that you know, we need to find a cure? And there, and the world becomes a very frustrating place, actually. A very irritating, frustrating place. It seems people are obstinate, because I used to use precognition to warn people about all sorts of stuff, and they didn't pay any attention. In fact, got mad at me for even warning them. Why? Because they wanted that stuff. That's a defense. That's part of their defense system against mental chaos. Having bad stuff happen, traumatic stuff happen, that's way preferable to experiencing mental chaos. So, at least that's sufferable, whereas mental chaos is insufferable. So, they got very upset with me. And then I got upset with them, saying, hey, I'm just trying to help. Why are you so upset with me? And then there's this conflict. So, by seeing things in the right perspective, then we forgive the world. We can forgive everyone. Say, oh, I forgive everyone for being so obstinate. So I'm sort of feeling like this. There's this potential for release from the world. Release, because I'm been wrapped up in kind of frustration towards the world of not being able to get it and not being able to get better, you know, and feel my life is useless. I haven't been able to help anyone. Everyone's still suffering. I've been able to, you know, find the cure for cancer, find the you know, the cure for unhappiness and old age, and haven't been able to help. Then now I'm seeing like, ah, of course, I see it now. Well, I can't really help in that way. It's impossible. And I forgive people their obstinacy, their stubbornness, their refusal to change, all this stuff. Now I see why. So it's a very forgiving perspective. It's like a miracle, really. It's like a miracle perspective where you see the potential for release from your own frustrations and antagonisms and Why is the world so crazy? Like, now you know why. So you say, oh, they need to be crazy. Okay, it's actually smart. So the world is not dumb. It's actually smart. It's doing what it needs to do. Where the ignorance is that they don't, the spirit doesn't realize it can choose a new idea. Because it's so frantically defending against annihilation, it feels like it cannot spend any time or effort to consider anything else other than defending against this mental chaos. So when the idea comes in of choosing a new idea, it actually causes a lot of anxiety because you're now considering this other idea and not working so much on your defensiveness. So that gives rise to anxiety, actually. So the spiritual path, I would say, does give rise to anxiety. But it's not the type of anxiety that should be medicated. It's a different type of anxiety. It's something that you're willing to take on, saying, look, this is the suffering that's going to happen when I'm not giving my full attention to defending against mental chaos. I'm going to feel this sort of inner dread as I consider choosing a different idea. You see, it will give rise to the sense of sort of nervousness and inner dread. You're not sure where it's coming from. It's because it comes from the fact you're not spending all your time defending against the inner chaos. So there has to be a very wise perspective arise that it's not like, oh, these poor people, isn't it awful? Not really. That's not really, the sacrifice is a very willing sacrifice based on the necessity to avoid this state of mental chaos. So they feel like, look, this is like a limiting loss. So it's a wise investment. They don't see it as a bad thing. They see it as a wise investment. All the suffering, misery in this world is like a super wise investment. So you cannot argue against that, because it's true. I mean, that's a fact. But you can point out that it's possible to choose to change hypotheticals. That is the focus of real spiritual teaching. As Jesus said in A Course in Miracles, choose once again. Choose a new idea. Exchange ideas. Exchange belief systems, as he puts it. I say exchange hypotheticals. For me, hypothetical is more descriptive. It's what if. What if it were possible? So you can call it belief. I call it hypothetical. Exchange hypotheticals. That is the focus that has to be present on real spiritual teaching. That is the right focus. It's not to go out and wipe out malaria or wipe out AIDS or wipe out all this stuff, not to wipe it out. That's going to make things worse. In fact, all of that is a reaction to previous attempts to alleviate suffering. It only gets worse. It only gets worse. What really would tone suffering down is presence in the world of somebody who's not trying to get rid of suffering at all. That's what actually tones it down. Then people say, oh, okay, they're not trying to force me to drop my suffering, so I don't have to suffer that bad. I'll just have a minimum, just the bare bones, whatever I feel I need, and that's enough. So no backlash. That's why Ananda Maima said, whatever comes is equally welcome. Made no attempt, as far as attitude, to change anything here. No attempt to change anything. That is super, super helpful. That is the kind of presence that actually helps us. and all this terrible stuff is happening. She said, everything is equally welcome. I'm not trying to change anything here about the world at all. Everything's already perfect. Everything's exactly the way it is. Should be. Everything's exactly the way it should be. Everything's working perfectly. And we say, well, how's that possible? We talk about all these sufferings and deaths, but she says, yeah, that is necessary to defend against the mental chaos that arises from the idea of wanting to be change reality, be prime creator. So it is working the way it's supposed to work. However, you can choose a new idea. You're not stuck with this idea. God's not saying you must keep this idea. Now, what if reality were impermanent? We don't need to entertain that idea. We can say, well, I'm tired of that, entertaining that idea. It's all it leads to is this constant sacrificial scenario. So let me exchange that for what if reality were permanent? What if I didn't want to be prime creator? That's the goal. So we may be overlooking, teachers. May not be willing to entertain them because we're so obsessed right now with removing suffering that we only define a teacher as someone who's doing all this charity work, all these hospitals, all this healing work, teaching us how to be happy, how to live here and happier, how to minimize our suffering, all this kind of stuff. We think that is a teacher. It's not. That is not a teacher. That's the opposite of a teacher. That's the Antichrist. The Antichrist is the one who's trying to make this world into a utopia. That is the Antichrist. That is the one who causes even worse suffering, exponentially worse suffering from backlash. The real teachers are the ones who come here and say everything is perfect exactly the way it is. I am not trying to change anything whatsoever here. It's all good. However, if you like, let me tell you, you can choose a new idea, exchange hypotheticals, and you will experience bliss from that. So I'm just showcasing the effects of this other idea, but I'm not here to try and change the suffering of the world at all. That's the real teacher. That's the Christ within us manifesting in this world. That is the true teacher. That's the Holy Spirit. And of course, most of the world won't recognize that. They'll say, that teacher's not compassionate. What do you mean everything's perfect? Everything's terrible here. Are you kidding? Look at everybody's dying. You got to stop that. We got to increase our longevity. We got to live to be 120, and we don't want to have, we don't want to be sick. We want to get rid of these sicknesses and illnesses. We want to, this. What we don't realize is that is actually bringing down severe backlash upon ourselves. We're actually going to rebound from that and entertain a much, much worse suffering scenario, much more intense sacrificial scenario based on that. Whereas if we just have this attitude of thing is already perfect, whatever comes is equally welcome. The suffering is just the price I'm paying to defend against mental chaos. I don't need to make it more. I don't need to make it less. And when I can instead turn my attention towards exchanging hypotheticals, which of course is going to cause a sense of anxiety in me, but that's the price that I'm willing to pay. And then go on that path, and then that eventually enables you to exchange hypotheticals and experience the presence of bliss and relate to that bliss. That's the actual path. Ramana Maharshi was not out trying to cure malaria or cure the ills of the world. He's just sitting there quietly. So just abide in the self, abide in this bliss. So people might say, well, it's irrelevant to this day and age, irrelevant. Because this is the age of wiping out suffering. He was incapable of doing that. But now we can get all these NGOs going, and we're going to wipe out suffering on the planet. Everyone's going to be party down all the time, 24/7. Everyone's going to be happy. Totally ignorant of the fact that this will result in enormous, enormous doubling down backlash, rebounding. then people will say, oh my God, you know, this is terrible what happened, absolutely terrible. And then they'll want to go back to a place, a 3D place of just, you know, basic suffering, basic defensiveness, and not such severe, basic sacrificial experiencing, and not such a severe one. And then give their attention to the spiritual path, which means a simple life, a humble life, a life of a certain amount of anxiety, actually, a certain amount of nervousness, but a life ultimately that leads out of sacrifice altogether by exchanging hypotheticals. That's what it leads to. So the real teachers tell us the spiritual path is difficult. It's one of, there's a certain suffering attendant upon it, which is certainly true, is a feeling of nervousness, of fear, because you're no longer investing so heavily in defensiveness against mental chaos, because you realize you're going to exchange hypotheticals. So this whole dynamic of mental chaos and defending against that whole dynamic is going to not be present at all. So we really don't need to worry about it. But that does give, as we're working on it, it still gives us a feeling of anxiety, nervousness, like, hey, I don't think I'm, you know, defended enough against it. Or if we don't succeed, then we're going to be an enormous rebound effect in our own lives. If we don't succeed, and we give up, say, oh my gosh, I'm not defended against it. I got to double down and triple down and live a terribly suffering, sacrificial life in order to defend against it. So we may think that these people dying on the street of Calcutta is like a blight upon the earth about our lack of compassion and how we have to make sure that everybody is fed and medical care and all that kind of stuff, cradle to grave care, so we don't suffer. But the person dying on the street of Calcutta is doing so as a defense against mental chaos, experiencing mental chaos, and although they're suffering taking place in misery, for them it's like a super deal. You know, it's like the best deal possible. They say, ah, by just sacrificing this body like this, I'm purchasing a measure of distance from that mental chaos. And they think, wow, what an incredible, great, great deal that is. That's actually beneath the surface what's going on. And all suffering and all trauma and all misery on the planet, that is what is taking place, is people feel that they are purchasing an enormously smart deal. And in fact, they are. But they are still ignorant of the fact that they don't have to cling to this idea of what if reality were impermanent. They don't have to cling to that. So it's a super smart deal, and yet there's still an overriding factor of ignorance about the fact that we can exchange hypotheticals that is present. So it is smart on one level. It is smart, but it's also, there's ignorance underlying the whole situation. So as we desperately try and extend this compassion everywhere in the world, what we don't see is the future about how it's actually making things much worse, which is something I have seen. So by being able to see the future and see what's going to come, then I'm able to say, now wait a minute, you know, everything we're doing now, it's not preventing what's coming, it's actually causing it. So that's why I said, whoa, everybody, let's all slow down here in our efforts to eliminate suffering. Let's instead take the path of inquiry, and let's look at the whole situation and say, what's going on? Because I know that what we're doing is leading to a terrible situation in the world. This backlash effect is not understood by the ignorant. It's not understood. It's the idea you cut off one head and two more spring in their place, like the Gorgon or something. Every time you cut off one head, two more arise from that. So every time you try to remove suffering, suffering doubles down. And then it's so confusing to us. You say, my gosh, I spent my whole life trying to get free of suffering, and now I'm suffering like way, way worse than before. And that's why some people who simply accept the sacrificial nature of life and don't struggle against it seem to live a pretty happy life. Not much bad suffering. It's the ones who want to try and get rid of the suffering who end up terribly. And then in that terrible suffering, they say, wait a minute. I've got to reevaluate the whole situation here because this is just not working. But oftentimes, it's just the simple folk who seem to live a pretty doggone happy life compared to most people, because they basically, they're just accepting their suffering as enough to defend against this mental chaos, and they're just saying, you know, they're just being good little sheep. But now we have in the world so many who are so high on their horse about we must remove suffering, we must enlighten everybody to the potentiality, human potentiality. That is what then brings the backlash down the road. Not immediate, but down the road. It builds, it builds, it builds. It's externalized. The lack of defensiveness against the mental chaos is, first it's externalized and projected to enemies here, enemies there. But eventually it comes home to roost, and there's a feeling that one must throw oneself to the wolves, as it were, and be torn to pieces in order to defend against this. It's better to have the body torn to pieces than to have the mind torn to pieces, as it were. So the mind says, this is a great deal. And the mind accepts it. Wow, this is a tremendous deal. Let the body be torn apart, but not the mind. See, the thing is, when the body's torn apart, it's temporary, but the body's dead, that's it, quickly. Whereas in the state of total mental chaos, it feels endless. It feels like it will go on forever. That's what I experienced. That you can't see any end to it, because it's total mental chaos. There's no way to establish any ending to it, because there's no beginning, no ending. There's no order to anything. So you feel as if it's going to go on forever. So that is what's so horrible. Whereas the death of a body, you know, suffering a body, you know it's come to an end after 70, 80, 90 years or whatever. And in sacrificial scenarios, the body quickly dies. And so there's an ending to the mind. Oh, that comes to an end. Loss comes to an end. Whereas mental chaos, there seems to be no way to find an end to it. No way. And that's what's terrifying. When you're not able to see any end or any way to bring suffering and misery to an end, then that's what's so scary. So we gladly engage in this bodily sacrifice as a way to say, I know at least that this suffering is going to come to an end. That's the defense. What is coming down the road in this world may be a surprise to a lot of people, because we are under the impression that we've gone a long ways to removing suffering from the planet, and we're on the verge of a golden age. What we're really on the verge of is an exponential increase in suffering and sacrifice, an exponential increase in sacrifice as a backlash to our misguided attempts to remove suffering, not realizing that suffering is a defense against mental chaos. We've not been following the right kind of teachers. Fortunately for me, I had access to awareness of genuine teachers. As I struggled with this whole dynamic, having experienced mental chaos, total mental chaos, and then seeing the necessity to defend against it, I saw that, all of that. I saw, okay, and also I saw the reluctance to drop this idea altogether and jump back to reality. I said, there's a continuity problem there. There's this mental chaos, and then there's the need to defend against it. I saw the whole situation. And then I said, well, what do I do? What do I do? And then I started to get the help from genuine teachers who have worked to point out the actual necessity to exchange hypotheticals. And that's the answer. So getting that sort of help leads to clarity. Not getting it leads to worsening of the situation. So hopefully we can get some real teachers here. And maybe there are some here. We need to be identified. We need to find them. Hopefully we can be real teachers. But it's not easy in a world that is dedicated to removing suffering. It is very difficult for teachers to be recognized here, real teachers be recognized here. We might get irritated with him. We say, well, why are you just sitting there like a statue? Why aren't you, let's go down to feed the homeless people. Come on. The idea, you know, I often think, what if a real teacher were here? We say, well, hey, everybody, let's get together and let's feed all the homeless people and let's, you know, help them out. Let's get them dental care. Let's get them, you know, let's get them medical care. Let's get them, you know, they need some medication for their mental illness. Let's help them. Let's help them. Let's help them. And the idea is that the teacher would galvanize a great wave of compassion in the world to help the people suffering, remove their suffering. Well, that's the opposite of, that's the Antichrist, actually. That's what makes things actually worse. When you see, now, let's say you see a homeless person. They're starving, and they're you can see they're suffering. What do you do? That seems to be a dilemma. So we don't know. First we have to say we don't know what to do. We don't. Let's not a priori assume that, well, of course we do everything we can to help them. Because it may be that that homeless person, the situation that they're in, is their best defense against this mental chaos, and they feel like this is a very smart deal I'm making, and I need to make this deal, otherwise it'll be much worse for me. So the question of how much help to give is a very relevant question, and one that I cannot answer right this instant. I think the best help is simply to be in bliss, to be relating to bliss. And then from that standpoint, see how people react to it. And if the homeless react to it as saying, I'd like, can you give me some food that you have blessed or something? Prasad, they call it in Hinduism, prasad. Can you give me something? If they request it, if there's something comes from them, then that is something that can be done. In other words, they're saying, okay, maybe I can back off this deal that I've made. Maybe I can make a better deal. Maybe I see some better deal possible. So. People are out there talking about my garden and how I set it up and everything. They're examining it. See, we want to do something like this, you see. Walker buys, see the garden, they say, oh, that's really nice. We got to do something like that. But again, that's not the answer. So abide in bliss and then see who wants to help. I believe that is the necessary situation in this world. Who wants to help? So they say that when the aspirant is ready, the guru appears. If the guru has not appeared, then it's because the aspirant still is wanting to use the guru in the wrong way in the world. And they'll be confused when they come across the guru. They're going to be confused. They say, how come you're not willing to go along with my agenda of you know, let's feed all the hungry in the world? And the guru will say, no, that's not it. And you might say, well, you can't be a guru. You're just on some spiritual ego trip or something, you know. So by seeing this clarification that has come out today, this clarity that has come out today, it puts a different spin on everything. It actually makes it possible to come across a genuine teacher, doesn't it? It makes it possible. Because still talking about the yard. Oh my gosh, okay. So like me, is an example. You plant the yard, you make it, and those people who like it, they want advice. Hey, I want to do this too. They will be interested, whereas those who are not interested are not interested. Not all hungry people necessarily want to be put into abundance. We just assume that everybody wants abundance. That's not true. Everybody is accepting the deal that they feel is best to avoid mental chaos. And you cannot necessarily force them into some other deal, or else you're going to get backlash. So, abide in bliss. Find those who are truly abiding in bliss. And get advice from them. Hopefully we can, more will arise, more will appear in the world. Or, even better, within us, the presence of bliss will make itself known. And we realize it's not a selfish thing to abide in that. It's not selfish at all. We feel, if we're abiding in bliss, we're taking time away from going and feeding the hungry. Again, let's be very careful about that. The idea of taking our time away from making the world a better place, that's actually a good thing. That's actually a very good thing. The more we simply let the world be the way that it is, the more the world is helped, actually. Because then the less defensiveness is needed. So there's sort of a stable, steady, sacrificial thing. And then from that standpoint, the path, spiritual path, can be taken. But when we're constantly trying to make the world a better place and they're experiencing backlash, better place, backlash, ping-ponging back and forth, we never get on the spiritual path at all. Oftentimes you see this, that the most successful spiritual paths are in very simple folk, country folk, who are just leading just kind of a normal sacrificial life of hardship. And they spend every day, you know, 4 to 8 hours in meditation, contemplation, spiritual reading, etc. Then they actually succeed. There's some success there, because they're not experiencing all this terrible oscillation between a backlash of advanced backlash, of trying to get rid of suffering backlash, all this constant turmoil. So it is possible at this point to abide in bliss, relate to presence of bliss, whether it's internally or externally through some teacher or something. It is possible. I can see from this perspective, it does remove the obstacles. Guilt is one of them. Guilt that you're somehow not helping the world or something is one of them. You're actually helping stabilize the world to a great extent. Now, stabilizing it in suffering is true, but that's actually a great advancement compared to this turmoil of backlash, double, you know, trying to get rid of suffering, then backlash, so that constant cycle of turmoil. That's terrible. So it's actually a great, great, great advance to simply stabilize the suffering and let people just lead ordinary lives of suffering and then pay attention to the spiritual path that they're able to at that point. So that's a great, great, great help. You see, someone who's suffering, if they suddenly feel like, hey, I don't really, the distance to the mental chaos seems to be quite sufficient, I don't quite need to suffer this badly anymore, then automatically they will diminish the suffering in their lives. Because they're the ones bringing it upon themselves in the first place. Everybody, the mind is bringing it upon itself. The mind will ease off. So really, if you want to help the world ease off its suffering, just do absolutely nothing. Be the guru that is not trying to change anything at all in the world. Let everything be exactly as it is without desiring that anything be different whatsoever. And you will find the world will ease off, back off its backlash. We might ask, well, what did Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maima do for the world and others here? They didn't seem, you know, they weren't trying to organize relief efforts or anything. They may have, undoubtedly, they did an enormous service to the world, helping the world back off of incredible amounts of sacrifice, intense sacrifice. Shorten the wars, you know, shorten World War II, shorten this, shorten that. Diminished it, and it helped the world back off of that. Back off the backlash. By simply accepting everything exactly as it is with perfect love, perfect non-judgment, not desiring to change anything whatsoever that's taking place. That enables everyone to back off the intensity of sacrifice into a more base level sacrifice, which then enables the spiritual path to be entertained more successfully, which then eventually results in exchanging hypotheticals and abiding in bliss. So that's how it goes. That's why when events happen in the world and stuff, I tend to not react to them one way or the other. Like I'll say, oh, isn't that awful? Isn't that terrible? I just get like a non-reactive sense about stuff. And then I feel guilty about it. Like, how come I'm not condemning this situation? But inside, there's a wisdom that just says, don't condemn. Don't condemn. Forgive. Forgive everything that's taking place, meaning don't judge it, don't condemn it. It might be better to use the term don't condemn or don't judge rather than forgive. Forgive means something that I don't know, the connotation for forgiveness to me, it brings something in which doesn't need to be brought into the picture. Like they can be taught not to do this again or I don't know, it just don't judge, don't condemn. Whatever takes place, whatever that happens is equally welcome. That's Ananda Maima's motto. Was that Jai Ho Ye Jai or something like that? Whatever comes is equally welcome. No condemnation, no judgment upon anything. Have that attitude, and you're actually doing an enormous service to everyone. So when everybody's acting out in sacrificial ways, don't condemn it. whatever it is, whatever it is, everything's happening exactly the way that it needs to happen within the context of this idea, and the Son of God has every right to entertain this idea because it has perfect freedom to entertain ideas, so there's no condemnation anywhere. So let go of the condemnation and work entirely at the level of the gospel of good news, of exchanging hypotheticals. The continuity issue has been solved by God's perfect non-judgment upon this, meaning we can exchange hypotheticals. What if reality cannot be changed? And then we can abide in bliss, and that from there we drop hypotheticals altogether. That is the way. And right now I'm sure that there are great gurus blessing the world through absolute non-judgment, non-condemnation, not trying to change anything at all that's happening in the world. So you have a situation like a city caught up in, like in the past, like in a plague. You bring the guru in there, and the guru simply has the attitude of let everything that's happening, no resistance to what's happening whatsoever. And you will find the plague will quickly die down. Quickly die down. As people say, oh, it's okay to just have baseline defense against mental chaos, and this whole situation is understood, and we're being reassured that we don't need to get rid of our suffering within the context of this idea we have. But we can exchange ideas, so we don't need any super, you know, try to get rid of suffering and the resultant backlash. We don't need that. We don't need that dynamic. So let's cool down here, and the plague will dissipate. Absolutely, will dissipate. Now there was a guru called Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, and his idea was that you have meditators in every place in the world, cities in the world, and that actually will reduce crime, reduce suffering, etc., etc. Well, that is plausible, as long as the meditators are not trying to get rid of suffering or cure anything, where they're simply abiding in bliss. That would actually take place, but the idea of leading to a golden age is not true. See, that part is not true. There's no such thing as a golden age within the context of the idea of reality. What if reality were impermanent? No such thing. There'll always be constant parade of sacrifice, which is not what we really want. We're tired of it. It's no fun at all. There's no such thing as a golden age. However, it would reduce suffering to a baseline, sacrifice to a baseline, necessary baseline, and then allow people to consider exchanging hypotheticals. That is very, very doable, actually. So if you want to define a golden age in that terms, you could. Whereas if you had those who abide in bliss all over the planet, ashrams set up in every city and on the planet, in areas, different areas all over the planet, and the people are simply abiding in bliss there, that would definitely diminish the suffering, the intensity of the suffering on the planet to a huge extent. And it would be reduced to a baseline. And from that baseline would come then consideration of exchanging hypotheticals. That absolutely would happen. But it also is true that all the modalities of trying to reduce suffering, people would lose interest in those too. So you have, the thing is, you have an enormous economy and industry on the planet of trying to relieve suffering. It's called the New Age movement. And it is actually enormous. It has got itself into every aspect of life now, where we need to bring all these new healing modalities into the planet. All these new therapies, like mushrooms. So, if you had people abiding in bliss all over the planet, what would happen is that people would lose interest in all of this New Age stuff. They would. They'd say, No, it's okay. The suffering I have is tolerable. I'm not really into the, any of that. And their attention would go away from that. So, ironically, the whole New Age movement is actually an Antichrist movement. It's at odds with what works, because it's actually going to create the backlash. The more you try and remove suffering, the more backlash. The more you oppose suffering and attempt to remove, the worse backlash you get. So all this attempt to give therapy and all these new therapeutic modalities and this desperate attempt to tweak our suffering in every way possible is making it worse. What would make it better is simply abide in bliss, the presence of bliss. Allow the presence of bliss to be with you in your mind, which then gives a feeling like everything is absolutely perfect. There's no need to change anything or no need to do anything. And then people would calm down and accept a baseline of suffering. From there, the spiritual path is much easier to take, the spiritual path, which leads to clarity, to exchanging then hypothetical scenarios to abidance and bliss and freedom from all hypotheticals eventually. That's how it would work. So that would be a true golden age. The true golden age is not an age of sophisticated modalities to remove suffering, of all this genetic engineering and snipping of genes and nanotechnology and all these therapies to try and open up our chakras and all these kinds of stuff. That actually brings about the backlash. So there is a great opposition to, at this time, to what works. An economic opposition. What is this? An economic opposition. An ideological opposition. So it didn't really take root. It hasn't really taken root. Keep in mind that the defense against male chaos, the desire to suffer, to minimize loss through suffering, through sacrifice, gives rise to desperate feel a need to suffer, which gives a rise to bringing suffering into your life through many different means. Whereas if you decide to accept just a low baseline of suffering, not much, you're not attracting that, pulling that into your life. So you're not going to attract the robbers, and you're not going to attract the muggers and the rapists and the traumatizers, and you're not going to pull that into your life. So it won't appear, it won't happen. Everything will chill out, will calm down, will cool down. The overall crime, the whole crime scene cools down. We don't realize that the mind is playing the suffering game, and we don't realize we bring it upon ourselves. We don't want to realize that because we're afraid if we bring it upon ourselves, we could also stop bringing it upon ourselves, which would then open us up to this experience of mental chaos. So we avoid seeing that we're bringing it upon ourselves. That is something that the world absolutely avoids seeing at all costs. So that's why a lot of, like, you know, prisoners and stuff, they all insist they're framed. Those who commit crimes, they all say they're innocent. They're framed. Well, that's not as absurd as it sounds, actually. At some level, somebody was demanding suffering of themselves, of their life, as a necessary, something that's absolutely necessary for them. And so the criminal is part of that dance, you see. And so the criminal says, wait a minute, I just did what was requested of me. You know, why am I being punished? That kind of thing. But in this world, that is in this dynamic, that is not recognized. So you do have all this criminalization. The basis of forgiveness is basically saying, I forgive them because I'm the one who requested the suffering of the criminal. That's the real basis of forgiveness, is that whatever happens to us, we're the ones who demanded it take place, very, very forcefully demanded it take place as a defense against mental chaos, as a necessary sacrifice. And so whoever does the victimization, we're actually demanding. So then we need to say, hey, wait a minute, I forgive them because I'm the one who actually requested it. That's the real basis of forgiveness. And that's something the world does not want to entertain. Because again, if that were true, we'd also have the option of not requesting it, which gives them the fear of experiencing mental chaos arises. We say, oh my gosh, I could request no defensiveness, no sacrifice, and that would leave me wide open. So it cannot really promote this idea successfully here. I don't see how it's possible unless you're very, very spiritually awake. Even though it's true, it's not something that it can directly promote it. You know, everybody's bringing their own suffering upon themselves. You know, the idea of, well, criminals are not really criminal is something that should be forgiven is promoted. Ideally, you could have a jubilee. There should be a total jubilee of everybody set free. They used to have that in wiser times. There would be jubilees. All debt is forgiven. All criminals are released. Everything, a restart, a reboot, complete reboot. This is actually way wiser culture than what we have right now. Our culture right now is again, very imbecilic. It doesn't understand what's going on at all in the world. But in the past, they would have reboots. The royalty, the rulers would say, okay, we're giving amnesty, a reboot to everything. Total reboot. Because there was an understanding in the past that somehow people brought the afflictions upon themselves. They said that they said it's because of their sin that God is punishing them. They put it in those terms. Like, why did we get the plague? Well, we must have been sinful and asked for it, which is true. That's exactly true. But they didn't take the further step. They had to distance themselves from a little bit, so they could say, well, we are responsible. They said, no, God brought it on us. They didn't quite want to say, no, we brought it entirely on ourselves. We're 100% responsible, because then they could say, well, we could not have any suffering at all. And then, where's the defense against mental chaos? There isn't any. See, so they couldn't take that final step. But they did at least partially realize that whatever problems they had, they brought upon themselves. That is very true. The ancients knew that, of course. They said, we're not leading our lives in the right way. Otherwise, this would not have happened to us. There's some partially correct. But nowadays, we don't see it at all. No, absolutely not. It's always somebody else, some criminal that's doing it to us, some bad guys. So it's the bad guys that are doing it. We've settled on a group of guys that are responsible. The world is basically, in its imbecility, looking for a group of scapegoats. It's pretty much the white male, you see, that is now the global scapegoat, the bad guys, for everything. They're causing all the problems. And then everybody can feel, secure, like, we're not bringing any suffering upon ourselves. Therefore, we can't get rid of it, you know, but we can, you know, get rid of it out there. So there's a sense of security coming from scapegoating, saying that you didn't attract your own suffering. Because if you realize it, again, you could also say, hey, I can also not attract it, my suffering. And then that makes you feel jittery. So we've lost that sense of being responsible for our own suffering, whereas the ancients actually had much more of that sense. And in losing that, sense, we think we've progressed. Actually, we've regressed. We're farther away, and we're going to bring worse and more intense suffering upon ourselves because of that. At least if we realize we're causing our own suffering, we can then ask why. Why are we doing this? And then that leads to spiritual wisdom. But if we keep saying, no, we're not requesting any of this suffering. It's all being imposed upon us from some bad guys out there. They're the ones who are doing it. Then we're ignorant about the dynamic. We're ignorant. We have no spiritual wisdom at all. And we're bound to make it things even worse and down the road. So suffering is helpful. We can look at it and say, why am I insisting that I suffer? You know, take personal responsibility for your suffering. Why am I insisting upon it? And then that leads to acceptance of the explanation, the real facts of the situation. And then you can say, freedom is possible. Freedom from all suffering is possible by exchanging hypotheticals. But how far away is the world from that? It's unbelievable how far the world has fallen. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It was pointing out a dynamic of the world. Is forgiveness for everything that's taking place. They don't realize they're all bringing it upon themselves. Again, we all crave suffering and sacrifice. And we all see it as a very, very necessary, very super smart, wonderful thing, because it prevents us from, defends against us experiencing total mental chaos. All that is very well and good and true. No arguments there whatsoever. However, we also insist that we're unaware that we're bringing the sacrifice upon ourselves, so that we're unaware we have the capacity to not bring it upon ourselves. That also gives us another layer of defensiveness. So we feel even more relief, saying, there's no way to stop this sacrifice. It's always coming from somewhere else. I can't stop it. I'm a victim of the world that I see. You see, that gives us more relief to say, I am a victim of the world that I see. There's nothing I can do about it, etc. That gives us another sigh of relief, like, there's no way that I can stop this, so it's a permanent defense. When you start turning that around, you're going to feel nervous, for sure. Start saying, wait a minute, maybe I'm not a victim of the world that I see, etc., etc. So, again, forgive the whole dynamic. Don't try to change it. Don't try to say it's wrong. It's not wrong. It's not wrong. It's right. For the idea that's being entertained is absolutely right. For the idea that's being entertained. However, we don't have to entertain this idea. That is the other side of the coin. To accepting it as it is, the other side of the coin is we don't have to have this idea. We can exchange for another idea. And we're just continuing on reinforcing here. Just reinforcing. Just showing that it's not just a blip of insight, that we can entertain the insight and wisdom. We can entertain it. It's not just a flash, like, oh, I got a flash, a glimpse of it, okay, and then back to our defenses. No, we can spend time entertaining this. That's a really satsang, is it's spending time entertaining it. The whole thing is spending time entertaining this, not just a split second glimpse, and then, okay, I got it. And that's it. No, that's not it. It's okay to spend time entertaining these clarifications. That's why these videos are long. That's essential. If you spend only 5 minutes at it, then you're going to be right back attracting more suffering for yourself. trying to alleviate it, and then actually going to making it worse. So the more time you spend entertaining truth and clarification, the better it is for you. So again, the service that I'm doing here with these videos that's being done here is the time spent on it, actually. It's right use of time, right use of mind. The time spent on it. It's not just the clarification, it's the time spent on the clarification and re-clarifying it. The hours spent here, that is the profound service, is just the capacity, willingness to spend time this way instead of going out there trying to, you know, alleviate my suffering or alleviate the suffering of the world. Again, it's all about letting, it's okay for the world to have a baseline of suffering. Don't attack that. Don't try to get rid of that. And then everybody can say, oh, okay, we don't need to intensify our suffering. Let's just accept a baseline. And then from there, let's clarify the whole thing and exchange hypotheticals. And then that's, we're out of here, truly out of here. That is the service. Anandamayi completely accepted death at any age, in any circumstances, did not react to it at all, in any circumstance. She just said that is their karma, meaning that is what they're attracting to themselves as a defense against mental chaos. And let it be exactly as it is. I'm not trying to change anything here. Let the play of death play out. Not the slightest bit reacting to it at all. Including the death of her closest disciples, including the death of her husband, death of her mother, everything. No reaction whatsoever. And she said to her, life and death, she said, it's all the same. It's all a defensiveness, a necessary defensiveness against mental chaos. But the idea that gives rise to mental chaos is not necessary to continue to entertain that. We can exchange it. The son of one of her disciples fell into a well and died. He was retarded. He fell into a well and died. And the disciple got very angry with her and said, you can foresee all the future. You've told us you can foresee everything. Therefore, you must have foreseen this taking place, and he did nothing to stop it. And she said, that is true. And the disciple was the mother was extraordinarily angry and upset and couldn't accept it for quite some time, maybe. But Anandamayi said, this is the karma. This is what this aspect of spirit has chosen to defend against, this mental chaos. And they must be allowed to defend against it. Because if I tried to remove this defense against it, it would make things even worse in the next life. They defend against it doubly hard, you see? So. And her husband died of the virulent strain of smallpox. Terrible, terrible suffering. And she didn't do anything to prevent that. And only just, I guess, hours before his death or something, I guess he must have given permission to have some of the pain relieved. And she just passed her hands over his body and the pain vanished for him. But up to that point, no. He insisted upon suffering through all the agony and pain and suffering of the illness, and she did absolutely nothing, or didn't react to it at all. Because again, he felt this was necessary for his defense, you see? So, and at some point, he had an epiphany and said, well, wow, wait a minute. I don't need this as a defense anymore. It's not necessary. And then she was aware of that, and then just pain. You know, was greatly diminished. She's able to just instantly do that. So it is possible for a teacher to cure all sorts of illnesses, etc., but only when the person decides that they don't need this intensity. It's not necessary for them. And they want some external force to appear to remove it which keeps their defensiveness in place. They don't want to admit that they brought upon themselves, that they can cure it themselves. They're not ready for that. So the guru comes and gives them a flower or something, or a drink of water, and the illness vanishes for them, or is greatly reduced. But they still want that element in play of it. Suffering comes upon me from God, and then God, so God can remove it or something. They don't want to admit it comes from our own mind. They're not ready for that yet. The best situation is for this presence of bliss to simply arise in one's mind, like that. And so it's not something external, some guru out there, that is bringing bliss to you. It's the bliss, you make it welcome within your own mind. That is the best situation. That you're choosing, that you recognize that you've only brought everything upon yourself as a defense against mental chaos. And then you forgive yourself for that. You say, I had to do that. There's no way I could not do it. There's no way that you cannot defend against mental chaos. No way. Okay, I know that for a fact. 100% for sure. There is no way you cannot defend against it. And there's no way it cannot arise from the idea of wanting to be prime creator. There's no way mental chaos cannot arise. So there's no way that you cannot defend against it. So you have to forgive yourself. Don't be angry at yourself thinking, I should have been able to not defend against it. No, it's impossible. Or it shouldn't have, that this effect shouldn't have arisen. No, that's impossible. It has to arise. The idea of wanting to be prime creator, meaning the necessity to change reality, meaning the reality will be annihilated, that fear of annihilation has to arise. And it has to be symbolized by mental chaos, and it has to be defended against. There's no two ways about it. So in seeing that, you can forgive yourself. And saying, I had to bring this suffering upon myself. And therefore, recognizing that you brought it upon yourself, you realize you have the capacity to let it go, exchange ideas, so that suffering is not necessary. By realizing the total necessity of suffering within the context of this idea of impermanence of reality, what if reality were impermanent, by recognizing that total necessity, you also can recognize the total necessity of bliss arising from the idea of not trying to change reality. That's also a total necessity. So by actually forgiving yourself means recognizing the total necessity of it, you then are willing to also exchange ideas and experience bliss. It brings you to the doorstep of bliss. So forgiveness of yourself brings you to the door to bliss, which is itself a total necessity from the hypothetical of what if reality can't be changed. That is an absolute necessity, necessary effect of that idea is bliss, the bliss of non-judgment. Just as much a necessity as the necessity of suffering, sacrifice is for the idea of a hypothetical, what if reality were not permanent, could be changed. Just as much a necessity. Both are 100% necessities. It's just a matter of which one do you want, which one do you choose. But don't try to bring bliss to the sacrifice. You see, no, that's what caused the problems. Just say, realize the sacrifice is necessary for this idea, and bliss is necessary for this other idea. Now, which one do I choose? Not trying to unite them. That brings the problems. Not trying to knit them together. That's what brings the backlash. That's what makes things worse. So that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get to a choice, one or the other, but not both. Not trying to knit them together. Not trying to bring bliss into suffering and sacrifice. Let the suffering and sacrifice be what it is. Let the bliss be what it is. Choose between the two of them. They're from different effects, 100% necessary from different ideas. 100% necessity. You cannot remove the 100% necessity of sacrifice from the idea of the reality is impermanent. You cannot remove it. You can only make it worse if you try to remove it. So forgive yourself for all the suffering that you've been through sacrifice. It was necessary. Yes, you did it to yourself. It was necessary. Because you cannot abide in mental chaos. It's impossible. You have to defend against it. So you had no choice but to defend against it. Jesus might have said, Father, forgive them, for they have no choice but to defend against mental chaos. They have no choice. Let them forgive themselves. Jesus forgave them. Showing that forgiveness is the way. Forgive yourself for bringing all this sacrifice, this experience of sacrifice of bodies. Forgive yourself for that. You had no choice. You had to do it. What was forcing you was the idea you chose of wanting to be prime creator. That is what necessitated it all. It is impossible to have that idea and not suffer this way. It's impossible. It's total necessity. So we're getting to the root of forgiveness, which then brings us to the doorstep of bliss. Hands us off, hands the baton off to bliss. It's really like that. It's like that. Forgiveness hands the baton off to bliss, and then one abides in bliss. And we better do that quickly. Otherwise, we may get caught up in judgments and non-forgiveness. We will say it's impossible that the world, that we could all brought this suffering upon us. Just not possible. The sacrifice will get so terrible, we'll think it's impossible that we could bring this upon ourselves, being unaware of the dynamic that's really at play, unaware of it. And that we could easily get sucked into judging ourselves, refusing to forgive ourselves, because we think others can, no way could others forgive themselves for what they're going through. And that's the problem. So forgiveness of ourselves for all the suffering that we've insisted on, and our inability to escape it. You know, we keep thinking we're stupid, but like, how come we haven't been able to escape it? Why? Because we've been operating at the level of effects instead of cause. We've been searching for the answer at the level of effects instead of the level of cause. Because we didn't want to admit that we have the capacity to choose this, thinking that means we might have an instant of lack of defense against this mental chaos. And so we're terrified of that, so we don't want to admit that we chose this. We don't want to admit that we have the power of choice on this. We want to insist that there's some inexorableness to it, and that we can only work at the level of effects instead of cause. We only feel safe working at the level of effects instead of looking at the level of cause. We don't want to realize that we can cause this upon ourselves, because we think that we could get rid of all suffering and misery. We equate that with then experiencing mental chaos. We don't realize that exchanging ideas doesn't give any instant for mental chaos to arise at all. It's a smooth exchange. Because God never judged hypotheticals ever. And this non-judgment was concurrent with the arising of hypotheticals. So there isn't any judgment. Bliss doesn't have any judgment at all upon suffering. Bliss is not trying to cure suffering at all. Bliss simply has never suffered. Doesn't relate to suffering in the slightest bit. So there's not a moment of judgment. There's not a moment of condemnation from God. None. None whatsoever. So we can look at the situation from the standpoint of causation, of choice, which is necessary. Otherwise, at the level of effects, we just make us worse for ourselves. Struggling at the level of effects to get rid of suffering, it makes it worse. So bliss doesn't know anything about reducing suffering. It has no consciousness of that whatsoever. Bliss is simply bliss. Non-judgment. Peace of mind. Never suffered. Bliss has never suffered. Bliss has never experienced fear. So it's true, it cannot relate to suffering in the slightest bit. It doesn't need to. That's not its purpose. It relates to reality. It relates to the idea of what if reality were real. That's what bliss relates to. So one hand, it may seem impersonal, but on the other hand, there isn't any need to experience mental chaos. There's no moment of judgment. There's no gap where we experience mental chaos at all. In other words, there's no gap where suddenly our defenses are removed, all our suffering and sacrifice is removed, and yet the effect of mental chaos still remains. There is no such gap with bliss, none. Because bliss is not a removal of the effects of one idea, it is the effect of another idea. In other words, bliss doesn't arise because we remove the effects of an idea, kept the idea but removed the effects. No, it arises as the effects of a different hypothetical. So bliss doesn't have any within it. Within itself has no gap at all. There's no gap there. And so the exchange, it suffering, sacrifice, and mental chaos all go together as one. They're dropped together at the same time, concurrently. So the lack of suffering and mental chaos, both of those go concurrently. The same instant. So you do not be stripped of your defenses with the fear of annihilation still present. That's not possible. You can forcefully try to get rid of all defenses and drop those effects and maintain the idea, and then you will experience mental chaos. That's what happened to me. You can do that, but that doesn't work, you see. That don't work. You can try and insist on dropping your suffering and sacrifice without dropping the causation of it, and then you will find yourself then in a state of total mental chaos, which then you realize you have to defend against it. So that doesn't work. That doesn't work. So what we're saying is exchange ideas at the level of causation and choice, and you set down a coin, both sides of the coin are being set down at the same time. It doesn't matter what's heads or tails. You're setting the coin down, both sides are being set down. So mental chaos, the fear of mental chaos, and the defense against it are both set down together. And again, we're in no hurry. Entertaining this idea, this concept, entertaining it. When you're in entertaining company, are you trying to hustle them out the door? Well, sometimes. But here, we don't want to do that. We don't want to hustle them out the door. We want to say, sit down, stay here. Have a drink, have some snacks, and relax, and we're going to spend some time here. No hurry, no worries. Don't try to hustle them out the door. Don't say, hey, I got to go somewhere. You know, oh, okay, I got to go somewhere real quick right now. In other words, don't go right into back into defensiveness again. Accept a baseline for yourself. It's okay. Accept your baseline. Whatever is your baseline, that's okay. I'm not trying to eradicate my suffering. It serves a purpose, a very important purpose. What I'm trying to do, I'm not trying to eradicate, I'm trying to choose a different, exchange hypotheticals. I'm not trying to eradicate anything. I'm trying to exchange hypotheticals. I'm not trying to see a happy world. I'm trying to exchange hypotheticals. I'm not trying to, you know, make this world a suffering-free place. No. I'm trying to exchange hypotheticals. I'm not trying to work with effects. I'm trying to exchange causes. I'm accepting the exchange of causes. I'm accepting it. I'm making a simple prayer. Bliss, abide with me, bliss, abide in my mind that I may relate with you, to you. That I may be in relation to bliss, that I may get familiar, used to you. When you're relating, you mean you're getting familiar with it. That's all. Getting used to it. How do you get used to someone if you're not, you know, living with them or hanging out with them? You cannot, of course. If you want to get used to someone, you spend time with them. So, in order to get used to bliss, you need to spend time with bliss. So these videos are like a precursor to kind of a warm-up, that warm-up act to kind of get you comfortable with the rationale behind it, the facts behind it. Bliss is not a tool that you'll be using to eradicate suffering in the world. It's a showcase to show others what is possible as far as choosing a different hypothetical. That's what it is. So don't feel like you need to use it for something like, oh, Mike, I got the bliss. I need to go out and plant flowers everywhere. I need to go down immediately and start feeding all the homeless. I need to set up all these NGOs and get all these donations. I need to fight the scourge of this or that. Don't feel that bliss is some energy you're supposed to be using to fight against suffering. It's a showcase to showcase others the way, the right way. And bliss seems to be incredibly non-active, incredibly passive, incredibly unconcerned. Bliss is unconcerned. There's no concern at all in bliss. And so we may feel like, oh, what is this? There's some people who are so, you know, those who are so into the idea of wanting to become prime creator, they view bliss as the devil, you know. They're terrified of it. They say, where's the concern? Where's the compassion? You should be totally concerned in about effect, you know, all this. And so they see it as, that must be the devil. That's what they say. It has to be the devil. Yeah, if you try to force it on them, they get very violent, very frightened about that. Because of the total unconcern about bliss. Total non-judgment. So the more people are calling suffering to themselves, the more adamant they are and arrogant they are that they want to be prime creator, and they think they know a way to do so. And that's spiritual pride, arrogance. And so they have to defend severely against mental chaos. They have to defend against it. Now, like good therapists, and there are some in the world, there's some intuitive therapists in the world that are the kind of sort of get it intuitively, their sense is to return the patient to a baseline of suffering, not to get rid of suffering, but to return them, to get them to accept a baseline of suffering, which is how you alleviate mental illness and all the problems, the severe problems, is to get to convince them to return to a baseline of suffering. Now, see, in my case, I was unwilling to do that, so I pushed it all the way through to experiencing mental chaos, because I don't want any. I want to be free of suffering, but I accepted the tenets of the world of how you're supposed to go about it, which brought about, you know, disaster for me. But the wise therapist will say, no, just return to a baseline of suffering. But most people, they don't want that. They want to eradicate suffering. So first return to a baseline and then consider how to exchange hypotheticals. That is the way. So there are some good therapists in the world. Some good therapy is being done. And yet we more and more and more we don't accept that. You know, just basically live with your suffering. Just live with your suffering. You have a problem. Just live with it. Don't try to eradicate it. I had a situation with someone that they had a severe problem, and I told them just it somehow they went into remission, and I said just live with it. There was still some evidence, but it was the intensity decreased, you know, 100-fold. I said just live with that problem. And they said, no, I got to eradicate it, because I want to prove to my disciples that I have the power. You see, I can help them eradicate their suffering too. So I have to show that I can eradicate it too. And I said, if you do that, it's going to come back worse than ever. And that's exactly what happened. The intensity came back, you know, tenfold. It came back severely. That's why sometimes gurus actually have some physical infirmity or something. It's a way of just showing people, hey, don't try to eradicate your suffering. Both Ramana Maharshi and Nisargadatta had some type of cancer. Now, they didn't have to, but for some reason, they're just saying, hey, look, everybody, just accept whatever suffering comes to you in your life. Don't struggle against it. Just keep your focus on causation, true causation of choosing a new idea. Keep it on that. Now, could they have dropped it? Absolutely, like that. And my mom was sick a lot of the time, but she said it was the karma of her devotees. She would allow the forms of sickness, of suffering, to come to her, and then she just didn't try to do anything at all about it. And by allowing it to be what it is without resistance, it automatically softened up, mellowed out, and returned to a baseline. The intensity was taken out of it, and then it would depart from her, and then she could get well in an instant. when it decided to depart, it would depart, and her health would be returned instantly to flawless condition. So she allowed all these different forms of illness to come and play with her, and have to be there, and the intensity of the illnesses would diminish. Cancer came, a lot of different afflictions. And she wouldn't do anything at all to ameliorate them at all, nothing. She just say, why should I send them away? They wanted to come, let them come. When they want to leave, they'll leave. So they experience no resistance to it, no resistance, no judgment, no condemnation. And then they return to a baseline. And who knows what a vast help that it was to the world, actually. Let all illnesses return to just a basic baseline. The more we try to eradicate suffering, the more virulent the illnesses become. That is a fact. So the world is going toward more and more virulent illnesses, which is why they're concerned about bird flu, you know, which is one of the more virulent illnesses, Spanish influenza. It's named the Spanish influenza because the rulers of Spain, the king royalty of Spain at the time, was World War I, and Spain was like neutral, and so the press was not controlled in Spain, so the press was allowed to report on this influenza. What was that, H5N1 or something, or maybe it was something else, H something N something. They were allowed to report on the illnesses in that country. So everybody around the world thought that that's where the illness was, that it wasn't anywhere else, it was in Spain. The fact was it was all over the world, but that the press was being censored and weren't allowed to talk about it. That's why it was called Spanish influenza. The fact is, in India, it was way worse than in Spain. It was terrible in India. That's where the most people died. So this HHN, you know, influenza, H something and something, is very dangerous. And the more we try to eradicate suffering in the world, the worse the illnesses become. So you're bound to get some H something and something terrible at some point. You know, you're bound to get plagues, and that's why the tribulation period, it was foreseen that it's coming. It's absolutely coming. And a severely contagious HN virus, bird flu virus, of course, it could shut down transportation, which will shut down, you know, the economies of the world. It would be a disaster if it becomes easily transmissible. And of course, we have scientists producing these easily transmissible forms of the illness. Supposedly to study cures for it, etc. But though, we keep kicking the can down the road, and eventually we end up down that road where the can becomes a bolt, you see, and we can't kick it down any further, and then that's when things, tribulation period happens. And we're basically at that point now. And we're going about the wrong way. We're going about in the scientific way of continuing to develop more and more severe ways to eradicate it. And you're getting all these, you know, resistant forms of bacteria, resistant to antibiotics, resistant to treatment. You're getting resistance to, like, fungicides, herbicides, all that kind of stuff. Or you're getting Roundup-resistant crops that, you know, the weeds and insects, etc., do the sprays. So you're getting this whole resistance to all the modalities of attack, of eradication that we've used. And at some point, we'll be in that phase where our drugs and medicines don't work anymore. And that's when we get these boulders of resistance, of suffering. And the suffering then becomes extraordinarily intense, and we can't contain it anymore. It becomes a contagion, like a wildfire. This is all totally foreseeable. The more we try to eradicate suffering, the worse the suffering becomes, the more virulent the forms become. Now, sure, we say we stamped out smallpox, and we've cholera is been dampened down. We've polio, and we're trying to dampen down all these diseases, et cetera, et cetera. But was it science that really did it, or was it the consciousness that we decided, hey, we can return to a baseline, and we don't really need this? Just a baseline suffering. It's not necessary to have this. Or did we kick the can down the road where there's some even worse plague, you know, to come? See, that's the question. So the foreseeing of the tribulation period is simply the wisdom, the wise knowing that we're going towards this epoch of intense attempt to eradicate suffering and sacrifice, and that would produce this enormous backlash down the road. And we can see that those who are sensitive. I mentioned one video, the dream of looking down the road and seeing how incredibly dark it is. Tinges of purple, but vast, dark sky, utterly threatening and dark and horrible. And then down that road, I saw this, just people going crazy and tearing themselves to pieces. Just utter horror down that road. That is the future. That is down the road. And we're very close to being, we continue to go down that road. Which is, we need this flat tire of satsang. We need to get flat tires. So we stop traveling down that road and say, whoa, wait a minute. Let's just go back to accepting a baseline here. Let's stop trying to eradicate everything. Let's get the attitude, let whatever comes is welcome. Whatever comes is welcome. Let's take that attitude. All right? And that back away from the apocalypse, back away from the tribulation, back away from it. And backing away from it, we can, you know, sidestep it. We don't need to go there. Now, it's possible to relocate to a place that has a baseline of suffering. I mean, most people are not ready to choose a new idea yet and abide in bliss. But it is possible to choose to relocate to a place of baseline suffering where all the modalities we have now for trying to eradicate it are not present, and live a simple, humble life and attend satsang. It is possible. Actually, everybody can relocate. We can all relocate to such a place. But of course, we will be leaving behind all these sophisticated modalities of attack, of eradication, absolutely. We'll be able to grow crops. We may not be able to grow surplus. You see, throughout history, we've been able to grow enough to survive. Baseline, okay? Hard scrabble life, yes. What we were not able to do was grow a surplus, much surplus. So the whole industry of surplus wasn't there. So now the world is so caught up in surplus, you see. But it has all these advanced forms of eradication. We eradicate the bugs, we give artificial fertilizer, we use power equipment to till the soil. That enables a surplus to be present, and a profit to be made off the surplus. Whereas in baseline 3D existence, you grow your crops, you grow your cabbage, you grow your potatoes, you have your chickens, you have your cow, your goat, your sheep, you have your pigs, you have whatever you have. Your garden, and you have, you know, little microclimate, little sustenance. It's basically more sustenance farming. And you may have a little bit of surplus. You may have a village farmer's market. Okay, sure. You have fruit trees. You're gonna have surplus, right? So you have your fruit trees, and you have your some grain. You go collective. You grow some grain. You have sustenance farming with some farmer's market, but you're not exporting surpluses, etc. Baseline, simple, humble life. You have humble clothes, humble dwelling place, humble life. But what happens is you get an inner contact with bliss, oftentimes. And then you say, hey, what's this? And then you have a lifestyle that enables you to contemplate and attend satsang to a great extent. A lot of these people in simple sustenance life, they're able to spend a lot of time reading holy scriptures, attending churches, attending places of worship. A lot of time, actually. Maybe every day they go. Because they're not obsessed with surplus, and then the commerce of surplus, and the commerce of profit, and then lending and debt, and this nightmare economy that we have now, of people's time and attention is completely obsessed with just this house of cards of commerce, of how do we keep managing more and more and more surplus? How do we keep capitalizing more and more and more capacity to produce more and more and more surplus, you see? So we can have more and more people here on the planet. Surplus people, surplus suffering is really what it is. You find that the simple people, who sustenance people, are those who tend to be more locked in on salvation, on truth, than the people who are obsessed with surplus. The frivolity of surplus. You go to the mall, now these people have surplus money, and they have surplus clothing, surplus everything, new hairstyle every other week, constantly going to the salons, buying clothing, buying gadgets, trading in their gadgets, constantly upgrading, surplus, surplus, surplus. Everything's disposable. They're not locked in on salvation at all. They're caught up in this terrible effort to eradicate suffering. So the simple folk, baseline suffering, they accept it. They can lock in on salvation, really can. And then this life that they lead can be the last one. They don't need any more defenses against mental chaos, because they've set that idea down that gives rise to mental chaos. They exchanged it for bliss. So it's possible to go to a 3D planet that's not obsessed about surplus, that each one just has enough. It is absolutely possible. It's possible to have fruit trees in your yard, anywhere you live, or the place you live, the village you live. There's fruit trees there, and the fruit trees are nourishing enough to sustain you. That's all you need. You have some water, and you have some fruit trees. And it's possible to dwell in such places. It's possible to dwell in places that your needs are met virtually automatically, actually. That is also possible. It's just that surplus is unheard of. You don't, the trees don't produce more than you need, as it were. That everything is keyed into the spiritual path and how to live a life, simple life. So where surplus simply doesn't happen, where dwelling places simply arise, but not surplus dwelling places, where what you need is easily available. Without much misery or suffering at all, then maybe there's a baseline of suffering, so you don't feel too jittery. But you can spend your time in satsang, in clarification. Such a place is absolutely possible. This world here now is so untenable; it's ridiculous. The world is absolutely caught up in this madhouse of frantic commerce. And how to keep the wheels of commerce turning. It's also possible to relocate to a fifth dimensional world. That might be just a pure satsang where everything is, probably the fifth dimensional world is like everything is provided automatically. You don't even have to worry about survival stuff. And you spend your time in satsang entirely. Third dimensional world, there's baseline suffering, but there's no capacity to produce surplus. So you just have what you, simple life, and you contemplate that way. That's possible. 5D is possible. Where again, you just have a fruit tree. What tree? You just pick the fruit. You need something. There's your meal. and it sustains you just perfectly well. Your whole system is set up to be sustained that way. And then beyond the 5D is the death-free realm, where there's no necessity for anything. Everything is sustained flawlessly and permanently without any effort at all. There's no death, no impermanence, nothing. No suffering at all. That's the death-free realm. And you simply abide in bliss, permanent, stable bliss there. It's just inherent. You cannot help but be blissful there. It's impossible to suffer at all in the death-free realm. So there are options. There are options. This dwelling place, this situation is not the only option we have at all. We do not have to be locked into this madhouse. I've never felt any desire for commerce at all in my life. I hate selling stuff. I only want to give it away. If I have something, I simply want to give it away. If I have surplus, give it away, free. Can't stand commerce. I mean, sometimes you're forced into selling stuff. For me, it's just terrible. So I must have come from some dwelling place where everything is free. There's no money. There's no need to sell. Everyone has whatever they need. And if there's any surplus, it's just, hey, if you want it, you want it. If it's not, it's fine. You get fruit trees, you get surplus. And just, hey, anybody who wants some, feel free to help yourself. I have a garden here. Tomatoes. If I have surplus tomatoes, pepper, I just give them away. Give them away to people if they want them. Make some salsa. Of course, it required a great deal of money to plant the garden and everything, so it's not really free to me at all. So it caused me a lot of suffering, actually. It caused suffering in various places. So, but the notion is there of no need for any money at all. If you have whatever you need to dwell in simple life, what do you need money for? You don't need money. If you go visit somebody, they may have a little surplus they keep for guests. I mean, you keep a little surplus for guests, and you go to the guests, they bring out their little surplus and they feed you, and it's all free. Stay, they have a guest place, stay. That's how it is. There's no hoarding. You don't keep big, vast hordes of stuff. So people share whatever is needed. People share it. Here, have this. Take this. Have some bananas. We have a tree that gave us a bunch of bananas here. You need them. Here's your bananas. Just whatever you need. Whatever it is. Don't try to keep some vast surplus for yourself. But in this world, the way the world is, everyone's driven to get a great surplus. I mean, in California, you need to have surplus in case there's earthquakes. Big earthquake would, you know, be disastrous. You have surplus in case, you know, the power gets knocked out, your refrigerator is out. And in case the economy collapses, you know, surplus like that. So, things have gotten out of whack in this world, so out of whack. And yet we think we're making progress towards eradicating scarcity. It'll get worse. It'll get worse. If you want to make things worse, just try to make things better. As I say, no good deed goes unpunished. So if we really want to make things terrible in the world, try to make it really a lot better, and you will find out what happens from that. Now, if you understand this dynamic, you don't need to go through this. See, this is the whole point of this. In seeing this, I see it. I say, oh, okay, now I see it. I've learned a lesson. Don't try to make things better. You'll make it worse. So I don't need to watch the train wreck. It's already, I understand the principle. That's all that counts. They say, those who don't know, learn from history are doomed to repeat it. Right. The more you try to make it better, the worse it gets. So, having learned that, you don't need to watch the train wreck. Because you carry the wisdom with you, and you won't repeat it where you're going. Whereas if you don't understand what's going on in the world, you'll think you need to stay here to learn a lesson. And then you'll go through this horrible situation and you won't learn the lesson. You won't understand. You'll just be bewildered and confused. So those who already get it don't need to go through this collapse and all these problems, because they don't need the defensiveness of it. They don't need that. It's not necessary. So what we're doing is removing the obstacles to a future that we want, and removing the obstacles to options we want to exercise. Again, we have the 3D option and the 5D and the death-free realm. Now, some people will also go into 4D, which is a focus on developing ways of eradication. But that leads you ultimately back into a 3D scenario of severe suffering, actually, which is many 4D people are in this world right now, and they're going to go through terrible suffering because eventually the backlash eventually reaches you. You know, 4D's attempt to have your cake and eat it too, which is to forestall the backlash as long as possible. And it is possible to forestall the backlash to some extent, but it's only delaying the inevitable. And at some point, you find yourself back in 3D, experiencing extremely wrathful situations. And you may end up having a long, long cycle in 3D, building up your defenses. So 4D is not advisable. Way better to go to humble life in 3D, or a beautiful life in 5D, wonderful 5D life of ease and very, 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 very limited concerns, effortlessly. And it's even better to go to the death-free realm. Great day here. Ridiculous day in California. Ridiculous. See, we live in California because we think that we can eradicate suffering here. That's the whole premise of coming here. People thought they'd come, there'd be gold everywhere, we'd all be rich, the climate's so incredible, we'd all be healthy, and we'd all have the food grows great, we have perfect food, water, recreation, health, wealth, everything, paradise. It was marketed that way to people. And people came out here and they all expected it. And you expect it. You expect to be free of suffering living here in California. But actually, what I experienced is the suffering gets worse. The suffering I experienced here in California is way worse than any suffering I've ever experienced in any other lifetime. Way, way worse. Because you drop the baseline. You think you try to eradicate all suffering, and then you end up with experiencing total mental chaos or severe depression, severe anxiety, etc. Because expectations are so high here. You can be extremely miserable here because of that. Whereas like a peasant in Kazakhstan was way happier because they accept the baseline of suffering, of sacrifice. Or in California, we want to eradicate. We think, here's the promised land. No more suffering, no more sacrifice. We're going to get it here. If we can't get it here, we can't get it anywhere. That can lead to, you know, severe troubles. So today is like perfect. It's like the most, like, if you wanted to dial in a perfect day, it would be today here. It's ridiculous. There's a gentle, soft, cool breeze. There's radiant, the sky is just incredibly blue. There's just this radiant heat from the sun. Everything's just bathed and sparkling. Everything is lush and green. It's probably about, I don't know how, today's going to be about, you know, upper 80s. But just incredible. All the insects are flying about in great happiness, great, you know, birds are chirping everywhere. Everything is growing. Everything feels fresh. The air is clear. And of course, an earthquake could happen. So that could also happen at any moment here. The big one, which we know is coming anytime, any moment, the big one. So it all seems so wonderful. But, and of course, then we're in drought. We're going to moving towards drought here, which brings terror of, you know, can't water your garden. If it doesn't rain next year, we'll certainly be into rationing, I would think. So all this beauty is very fragile. It depends on water. I mean, the lushness of everything here is because of watering, you know, daily watering. The citrus is doing great because of water, daily watering. We've been through drought here. We had to let the whole yard die, everything. Stop watering everything. Only those things which were native and hardy survived. Everything else died. That was terrible. It took about, you know, 15 years to recover from. It's just, it's when your entire situation dies like that, it's very tough to get it back. Very tough. Only the ivy survived. The pyracanthus, only the pyracanthus, oleanders, pyracanthus, and ivy, that's, and junipers, that's all that survived. You know, the rest of the stuff, delicate, beautiful stuff, all died. So yeah, on this day, everybody's out soaking it in somehow, trying to be happy. Except here, we're talking about the roots of no. Don't try to eradicate suffering. Forgive oneself for the necessity of the suffering. See the necessity of it, and therefore forgiveness. It must be. If it was totally necessary, how can I condemn myself? Why should I condemn myself for playing this game of bodies and in worlds and vulnerability and suffering and death and aging? Forgive myself for this ridiculous game of aging, of impermanence, of bodies, bodily identification and all this stuff. It was necessary. Necessary. All right. Very great. Done good work here. Spend some time here. And that's the big one. It's the big one. Okay, when you talk about success on the spiritual path, spending time entertaining these ideas, that is the big step forward. That's what causes you to really advance. It's not so much the insight, it's the time spent with the insight that is the true advancement. And it's all free, except for your internet connection. It's all free here. You know, that's my goal here, is to make it free. I don't want to have retreats where I'm, you know, charging people. I have a severe problem with charging anybody for anything. My goal is to give it all free of charge. So these videos on YouTube are essentially free of charge, other than the, you know, connection. So you don't feel like nervous about spending time. You know, if you're like on some Skype call, they're charging you $80 an hour or something. There's all these teachers are doing teaching on Skype and they're charging, you know, charging. And the thing that I hate most is no, it's all free, but donation is accepted kind of thing. Oh, come on, you know, that's even worse. Because then you say, well, how much? I better not get too much help, because that will make me feel too obligated to donate more. And so if I get a little help, I donate a little bit. If I get a lot of help, I donate a lot. Terrible. It's much better to have a set fee. Way better to have a set fee. Say, look, $15 for an hour of Skype. Flat fee. Way better to have a flat fee. Can't stand donations. Just hate them. So it's so disingenuous. You know, what's the flat fee? Can I pay it? Yes. No. If I cannot, I cannot. So it's either free or a flat fee. Forget about donations. They do this whole donation thing to get tax-free exempt status, so they don't have to pay taxes on their profits. but it's very much a disservice. Say this is the fee. If you need to charge a fee to whatever, survive, okay, I understand that. This is the set fee. And if someone can't pay it, then it's free. If someone doesn't want to pay, it's free. It's either one or the other. Decide. None of this sliding scale ambiguity, you know. You can set different fees if for different economic brackets is possible, but the ambiguity of donation, yuck. They get around it by saying, like, well, suggest a donation $10. In other words, the fee is $10 for it. But the idea is just pay whatever you think it's worth to you. Oh, boy. Because what if you know, are you going to spend 3 hours here then? No way. You're going to spend 5 minutes and say, okay, I got it. Thanks. Here's $10. Thank you. Because you may only have $10. So, or you may only have $5, or maybe only $1. And so you're going to say, hey, I can't spend 3 hours here with you because my mind is going to be a bill of hundreds of dollars or something, or, you know, a lot of money. I don't have it. So that makes severe anxiety. I've noticed that. Where it simply is free. It's free. In this terrible surplus world of commerce we have now, where everybody's supposedly supposed to produce surplus in order to make a livelihood, it's so impossible to live without a ton of money. It's absolutely incredible. I mean, as far as like the middle class is really being squeezed out of existence. Because in order to maintain a middle class lifestyle, you literally have to be rich. You really have to. Just to pay for the maintenance of everything, because the maintenance costs of all the stuff is so expensive now. Everything's breaking down, everything's obsolete. Every appliance, everything you get is going to need maintenance, and it's going to be obsolete soon, and it's going to break soon. Just to keep replacing stuff, the cost of it all is, you have to be rich to be middle class now. Nearing recording limit. Okay. You have to be rich to be middle class. And if you're just lower middle class, hey, really sort of just, you don't really want to produce a surplus, you essentially are going to fall into poverty class. And since you're not used to the tricks of the lower class uses now to get all the money from the government and to survive, which right now you have to work the system if you're poor to survive, basically, in this surplus economy we have. Middle class has no knowledge. I have zero knowledge of that, and no inclination to take a penny from the government. It's like a death sentence. So that's why I would say relocation is very important at this time. I mean, I don't see how I can rework my psyche to live off the government. I don't see how I could do that. I mean, those who survive, the poor who survive, are often extraordinarily shrewd and clever and know every single angle and how to cheat here, how to cheat there, how to be dishonest, how to lie, how to do whatever they need to do. They don't have a conscience whether they simply, this is what needs to be done to survive. Whereas the middle class, we're taught to be stand in line, be honest about everything, only take what is yours. Do not, you know, we're taught to be self-reliant. All this stuff is completely ingrained in us. There's no way in the world that we can be expected to function through the collapse where there's simply the rich and the poor. There's no way. That's ridiculous. You know, gentility is inbred within us. And if we have something, we'll just give it, you know, give it away. If we have a little extra, give it away, give it away, give it away. And it just, we're not wired to function that way at all. So I think it's super important that those who realize that they're going to be hit by this collapse, to relocate, the option to relocate. Preferably to a fifth dimensional situation where you're not struggling for existence. I mean, there's no way I could go out and be a farmer right now. Just planting this garden almost killed me. My system is not at all set up to be able to do that. Not everybody can be a pack mule, you know. Not everybody's capable. So what I need is just a fruit tree to pick the fruit and eat it, basically. So I need 5D. I'm not able to go to hardscrabble, you know, peasant 3D life, where some are able to do that, but I'm certainly not able to. A lot of the middle class is not able to do that. So I would recommend to the middle class.